Hello everyone, and welcome to this new edition of Initiative Africa. Today we head for Douala in Cameroon, where digital innovation is redefining standards in the livestock sector with a revolutionary application. But first, here is the summary of our program. Meet John Diemé, a young Franco-Senegalese entrepreneur at the forefront of a trend that combines culture and hairdressing embodied by barbershops.
A barbershop is basically a concept that comes from the United States which aims to mix culture and hairdressing and urban Afro-culture.
We take you to Douala, Cameroon to find out how a revolutionary application is changing the landscape of livestock farming.
Our concern in our collaboration with Gadju Livestock is to provide an action plan to support breeders and at the same time enable consumers and those who are fond of Gadju Livestock products to consume good quality meat.
From Mauritania to Senegal, we take you on a journey with pastoral families on the front lines of climate change and growing insecurity. Let's now embark on a journey at the heart of livestock farming in Africa, guided by the inspiration and determination of Engasa Fotso. His innovative vision has come to life in Gadju Livestock, a revolutionary application that is transforming the livestock industry in Cameroon and beyond. In this adventure where technology meets tradition, he's also opening up new avenues for livestock farmers and pushing them towards a promising future for African agriculture. A report by Maxime Fahal-Bounia.
After seeing his business go up in smoke during the Anglophone crisis, young Cameroonian entrepreneur Engasa Fotso came up with the idea of setting up Gadju Livestock, an application for buying and selling standardized and traceable livestock products and veterinary services. It's a revolution in the livestock and agri-food sector in Cameroon and across Africa, and users are already enthusiastic about it.
In fact, when using the app, I found a section for vets, home vets and farm vets. I clicked and paid online the amount I wanted to pay. A Gadju agent called me within a few minutes and we scheduled an appointment for the vet to come to my house to examine my little one. I used to go to a regular vet and I had to pay a bit more because of the transport costs. But with this app, everything is taken care of. So I think it's affordable because you don't go to the vet every day.
To provide to Gadju Livestock customers greater satisfaction and better support, the startup has made the wise choice to rely on qualified veterinarians in this country.
In the case of veterinary practitioners, you'll be asked to send your registration number for verification, as we work with doctors who are registered with the association who own clinics. So veterinary clinician like Dr. Hugh with his clinic on Rue Vavé. We also have Dr. Ngoc in Yaoundé and many others that we can't mention. Our concern in our collaboration with Gadju Livestock is to provide an action plan to support breeders and at the same time enable consumers and those who are fond of Gadju Livestock products to consume good quality meat. First of all, we are reaching out to the farmers and help them to learn how to rear and treat their animals.
In an increasingly digital world, the team is working tirelessly to ensure the inclusion of all players in the sector, including those in areas far from urban centers.
It takes a lot of time and a lot of tactics to convince them. And there are those who are very happy to sign up because it's a solution that will help them eliminate stress and transportation. And with veterinary assistance, they'll find what they are looking for.
Satisfying breeders who now avoid intermediary sales and see their profits increase. Gadju Livestock has positioned itself as a valuable ally
to those who aspire to manage their business more efficiently.
We also have a problem. When it rains, it's not easy for us, not easy to sell. But with Gadjo Livestock, we can sell online, even on site, so customers can see the quality and we can deliver them effectively.
Ordering via this application is simple and practical, as this fish farmer explains.
The process is quite simple. Firstly, Gadjo Livestock customer service department calls us, place their order, giving specifics such as the number of kilos, the average weight of the subject, the number of subjects, and related weights in kilos. We give them an order preparation delivery time of at least 5 to 30 minutes, depending on the quality requested, and their delivery driver comes to collect the order against a delivery note.
Aware of the huge potential of livestock farming in Africa, in Cameroon in particular, this young entrepreneur is not giving up and dreams of conquering the whole of Africa.
If we have the opportunity to put this in place, I think it will help almost everyone involved in livestock farming in several African countries, not just Cameroon. So the vision is great, and I invite all Africans to join our platform.
His dream of conquering the entire continent with Gadjo Livestock reflects his determination to inject a new momentum and promote sustainable development of both agriculture and livestock farming on the continent.
Our guest this week, John Dieming, has a fascinating and socially committed entrepreneurial story. Originally from the Franco-Senegalese diaspora, this forward-thinking entrepreneur is not afraid to take risks. He has imported a trend straight from the United States to France, adapting it to his dual Franco-Senegalese culture. Our journalist Lionel Cauchois met him in Paris. Take a look.
Bonjour, John Dieming.
John Dieming, hello. You are a young Franco-Senegalese entrepreneur, the co-initiator of the barbershop wave that has taken Paris and the rest of France by storm. You now run three salons and a franchise. Can you explain to us exactly what a barbershop is?
A barbershop is basically a concept that comes from the United States, which aims to mix culture and hairdressing and urban Afro-culture. We try to exchange ideas using different tools such as hair clippers and scissors to enhance a hairstyle and assert an identity. We're now a local business that attracts a clientele based on urban hip-hop culture, mixing all hair textures and communities in one place.
How did you come up with the idea of opening a first barbershop?
My idea for the first barbershop came from the first hairdressing salon I launched in Aulnay-sous-Bois, based around the model agency I had set up and which reflected gender diversity, so it was for men and women. And after that, I wanted to expand with a different vision. After doing a test sample, I wanted to see what I could improve and what the need were. From there, I launched my first hairdressing salon for women, and I wanted to separate the two. Why? Because there's an intimacy that men need and that women needed too. In any case, that's the spirit in which I wanted to launch it, and that's how the idea came about. I saw that we were in a new era where we were already had aging hairdressing salon, and now this new era influenced by Instagram, etc. I thought we could bring something that was missing, and I was a fan of a film called Barbershop in the United States, which inspired me a lot and made me want to bring this trend back home and do it with our own identity, even though we have the same hip-hop culture. But in terms of identity, we're not the same as the United States. I thought we could bring our own touch with things that were more representative of our community.
You then created Groomers in 2016, a new kind of barbershop. What was your initial idea?
My original idea was to popularize the profession of barbershop, which comes from Afro culture, an urban culture that we brought back from the United States. but which we wanted to put in our own style. The goal for Franco-Senegalese diaspora was also to set an example and make our mark on history. How is history shaping up? By doing these ads, we wanted to do something strong, but something that calls out and represents someone or a community to move forward. We know that today, at least for us, the tools I had were all about influence. We're very much about well-being and self-reflection, and hairstyling represent and affirms an identity. So having that exchange and being able to create something that was much stronger, that's why I launched the groomers, so that they could be representative and so that we could have a skill that could be passed on throughout the world. If tomorrow I take the example of young people who don't really want to do anything and I give them this love of doing things and becoming a barber, I think that with this profession, they will be able to use it wherever they go. And that's how I wanted to make my contribution to the diaspora. The purpose was also to make history and to say that we came here on a mission. What is our mission? Our aim is to find out how we can contribute and how we can give back what we have received.
You've created a real identity in your salons with your open cage concept. Why this idea of an open cage? Does it have anything to do with your own experience?
It has a lot to do with life experience because we come from inner urban areas, which can also be a blessing. We've been lucky enough to live in an environment that has taught us to be resourceful. But unfortunately, there are downsides too. And the cage is like a prison. It's to show that we're not destined to fail and that we're not forgetting anyone. And to make it clear, it's not a cage that can lock us up. We shouldn't be looking for excuses. Today, in reality, we know what we've been given. We know how lucky we are here, so that's a strength. The flashing lights are an alarm system to say that it's time to wake up, and also to say that the police are here and they're outside, and if we're not ready to arm ourselves mentally and properly, we could lose a lot. In the cage, you'll see that everything was done by us, and we did all the work ourselves to say that it was done by us, for us, and that we are capable. In our architecture, there are many things that are imperfect. There are many flaws. It's like people, they are full of flaws. We give meaning to our shops to ensure that they have a soul, because we are a craft workers. What comes out of craftsmanship is always the love you put into it. So that's why there's a cage. That's why there are flashing lights. That's why there are bars or coins to show its value. A penny is a penny, but money doesn't really matter if you don't put your heart into it doing things.
Welcome back to the second part of our show. I'm now taking you on an extraordinary journey. The transhumans of pastoral families in the Sahel who travel from Mauritania to Senegal with their animals. 20 million people live off herding in this vast region, and for the majority of them, the depletion of natural resources, water and pastures leads to conflict and insecurity. But since 2015, herders and villagers have gradually learned to dialogue through local committees. The regional project to support pastoralism in the Sahel, financed by the World Bank, has also achieved exceptional results. Take a look.
Se hodo gasi tan min e gan min jele ho hodo jaman hen waadi hen de min gonata min jaata tan balli di min jotto hen waadi hen de min badata hedde balli sa wala balli sa pujuy wala balli no gas enen wadi min keb hen caade gurno men wurt ma ayne yahna kaaki dem moje siko di moji mi waawa hen wur ko dum wurtim hen.
Mereka orang yang baik sih. Mereka nanti mungkin kita semua nak mendentin dah mir ayam suah kawar min curo. Min kat dah berjalan dua bagas ayam min jalan min tega dua sari. Soal perih min kap hatir min kap bumbu amin. Kaya kita indek parin jauh. Jadi gaya nak sarte dengan kap mengkapu.
Alahor kawatan ni hor hewah min guna doh hatok. Joinun odo zaman kam hor ustotan minja.
Comme taya ton ko fodo men tan de mon sadel problème diam ga ay gese mo men hen tan ke problème
ni men de tam haran di fol be gamaw do ke se wurno ne to bin ma ti do de kam hor ko do yiddi ndiyam nan de kam haram ye problème gabro bi on simin jahi an min ta hom wed han min ta bo do han min yollo jangal min gondo gota en fu dan bari li min gal hor ko noni no hor seeta no hor kam o nyam de kam min ne mankan nyam dan ye mborum sod ngorum ko non tan ngon re ngoram men min jog hen diam amen keddi ko on gor woram min ciode hen mar min ciode nebba min ciode hen dal wadde ko marge cewde min day min ciode ngawram dum win gor dum min ciode ko lisi
da fa def dama jangou tak ñom dama xey fi di bay ba wacc nit joge fu salum ñew fanaal ci pegg tol bi xeyna sa gisul tol bi mais day jurgi dañu wëtt guddi rek du ko yema naam fekk yow ko ma naam fekk yegnako waye man fekk man bayna ba ñibi jurgi wëtt guddi ñew fekk ñu dugg tol bi yaq lu bari ma ñew rek fekk ñu yaq sama ko topé dama ci man mom dara day ñak wa dama ñak li mo warona am rendement bi day wañi ko.
Le but de cette réunion, c'est d'engager un dialogue entre agriculteurs et éleveurs pour se comprendre, pour minimiser les conflits. On discute et on trouve des compromis. Avant la création de ce cadre, il y avait beaucoup de conflits qui ont même amené à des morts d'hommes, qui ont amené même à des empoisonnements d'animaux. Mais depuis la création du cadre, avec les concertations, avec les réunions que nous organisons au niveau des communes, au niveau des départements, il y a eu vraiment moins de conflits.
Merci à vous. Si vous avez des réfinats, il faut que vous ayez des problèmes. Si vous avez des
problèmes, vous avez des problèmes. 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 ayen bire an ka def non tan batta ma wa dem njangim ngana
and we welcome back our guest John Diemé for the rest of his interview. Proud to be from the Senegalese diaspora, the entrepreneur has chosen to be a leader for young people in his community. Let's find out how he inspires and motivates through his career and his actions.
How to explain the popularity of barbershops in France?
The passion is natural. It's thanks to the evolution of hip-hop. These days, we are part of emerging communities and that have purchasing power, that demand to be able to exist and to have something that is their right. In other words, quality, something trendy. We are just a natural extension of hip-hop. Hip-hop is taking over the world today and it's the number one music in the world. These trends like Afro, Afro music, etc. Nigerian Congolese culture and their music are part of this trend. The barbershop is the same vein. Today, we've expanded thanks to the influence of who have arrived with Instagram, the new network, Twitter, etc. So we are part of the trend and we've been able to catch the wave. And today, all the places, and people are attracted by the visual barbershop are visually pleasing, attractive, and Instagrammable. We are entering a trend where hairdressing has been popularized by influencers, footballers, and everything else that's trendy. So we've linked a professional to celebrities. The profession is gaining in value in attracting all these new young people. Given that we are in tune with the time, it was easy, really. So we got into the channels that meet a demand.
You have now opened your own barber school to train young people from the diaspora who have come from chaotic backgrounds sometimes. Why is this social dimension so important to you?
It's important for us because you have to know how to give back what you've received today. I'm one of those entrepreneurs who believe that entrepreneurship is a passion and a duty. And when you're a leader and understand why you're here and your life's mission, you have to contribute to the emergence of those around you, your environment. Nowadays, there's a lot of failure because a lot of people have been individualistic and kept things to themselves. They have had success, but it's been solitary. Today, we should be succeeding together because thanks to all the battles and the successes that we are going to wage together and that we're going to make progress through the transmission that will ensure that there is an impact on the community. A strength, and how I can put it, we were fed up with being victimized, always believing that we didn't have the means to do things when everything depended on us. So I think that today, working alongside people, going out into the neighborhoods, we've all seen what's going on. We've seen the capacity, the skill we have. Unfortunately, we've also seen the dark side. We've seen why, because we needed help. There are a lot of people who need help, a lot of people who need love, and if we manage to do that in our lives, and if we manage to give, I think we can save a lot of people, even if they can't save the world. We can save those around us, our community, just as we did. We set up a small barbershop in the 19th district. Today, there are barbershops all over the French-speaking world, in every French-speaking environment. And it was us, we were instrumental in this, not the United States. Before us, there was no such train. We launched something that had an impact. I think it really got things moving.
At your school, you also offer language courses in English and Korean, as well as African languages such as Wolof and Diula. Is it important for you to return to your own culture?
I think that's what has been paramount today. In any case, especially in the process of doing these languages course, is to say that we know where we come from. Languages allow us to know who we are in terms of our identity. It also allows us to move forward and talk to our grandparents and parents to find out about our history. We have to make sure that since we are the product of so much diversity here, our culture on both sides doesn't disappear. That's the most important thing if we want to be strong people and not lost people. That's why we wanted to set up the language course to start a trend. But beyond the language course, there's also the culture course that goes with it. And in our country, we say that there can be no education without culture.
You're planning to open a school in Senegal, your country of origin, in the near future. What are your objectives?
My goal is not just to open in Senegal, in Abidjan too, and then in another capital to import what we've managed to do here. Why do this? Because I think economic model and the social model are also very good. It has made an impact, and I think that we can do the same work that we have done here with codes from over there, thanks to the experience on the ground, which will be able to bring out what we have done there. The codes are not the same. The reality is not the same. The content has to be different, but the form will be the same. And the fact that we're going back to our roots also is to show that we have a mission. We came here on a quest, and now our quest is to come back and do the work and to stop simply sending Western Union thinking that they are being assisted, but to give them the means to get things done so they can turn in help us here too. there need to be an exchange, there need to be launch, but we also need to make people understand that we can't give you everything, we are not superior, but we have to make sure that the model we've put in place will help them to flourish so that they can too influence the world as they have already done in terms of music, dressing style and many other things. We just have to industrialize things in terms of culture. My medium is more cultural and social. That's how I do it. But you can do it through tech, through industry, and through a lot of things.
What are your ambitions for the future?
That's my ambition. It's to make my school grow so that it can be recognized worldwide, not just locally. The school, the course we offer, qualification we provide, we want to launch a real industry, a real craft, and ensure that it lasts and has a social impact on society.
And that's it. Initiative Africa is over for today. You can find the interview with John Deme as well as our programs on our website, africaonair.com. And of course, don't hesitate to follow us on our social networks, to share, like, and comment with the hashtag Initiative Africa. And don't forget to tune in next week, same time, same channel, for Business Africa. Have a great week.